The thesis is the revival of the heritage and ecological precinct of Sivri. Located on the eastern waterfront, Sivri is a part of the Portland and it is a part of the urban renewal plan of the Mumbai Port Trust. The Sivri Fort, the Koliwada, the mangrove edge and the flamingos make Sivri important in the subject of heritage and ecology. Right now, the site lies neglected due to declining economic activities and degradation of the environment. The Port Trust is a vision of turning the waterfront into an international tourism hub. The proposal aims to unlock the commercial potential of the site and focuses more on business and tourism activities. There are no strategies to strengthen the existing fabric. Instead, the site is imagined to be a clean slate. The thesis tries to question the top-down approach for development planning. Instead, it proposes the conservation of heritage and ecology for the revival of the precinct and community upliftment. That's the area under the Mumbai Port Trust, and that is Sivri. The site is well connected with the Harbour Railway Line. The Eastern Freeway passes the site, and there's an upcoming Trans-Harbour Link that will connect the island city to Navi Mumbai. Looking at the plan, that's the Sivri Railway Station, the Koliwada, the fort, the Flamingo Point, and the Sivri Jetty, which kind of allows for interaction with the edge. The Koliwada, the fort, the flamingos and the mangroves are the key factors that are interdependent on site, and conservation and preservation of one will automatically improve the conditions of the other. Looking at the site does not have much built form, so provides much more opportunity for development. The road network kind of adequately covers the site, so no need for large new road networks. There are very few residential pockets on site. Apart from the Koliwada, rest all of them are informal. The site is small and hence really walkable. Looking at the land use, most of the land is occupied by oil refineries. The other large portion is occupied by this empty plots of land which belong to MBPT, which has empty warehouses and dilapidated buildings. A small portion of land is also occupied by small scale industries and a few residential pockets here and there. There's a dargah next to the fort, and the dargah and the fort becomes like a great social space in the precinct of Sivri. The locals use it for recreational purposes. Other social spaces are kind of concentrated near the residential pockets. Very few economic activities available on site, and less employment. The site offers various edge conditions for mangroves and bird watching, while the fort is provides like an elevated view. The other two edges kind of gives more proximity to the mangroves and the water's edge. Sivri is basically a post-industrial landscape, and it has the potential to be returned to productive use. It can be reintegrated into the surrounding community by providing the basic infrastructure that it lacks. It lacks the physical infrastructure and social infrastructure, like there's no educational institutions, very few healthcare facilities, no affordable formal housing, less employment opportunities, no available markets, disregard of heritage and ecological degradation. Looking at what the HCP has to propose, so this entire land belongs to the Mumbai Port Trust, and the project right now is under Bimal Patel's firm HCP. So the planning for Sivri is entirely done just the existence of the Trans-Harbour Link. So this entire blue patch is proposed as transit-oriented district for office and retail. The fort area is marked as the historic district, but it completely lies isolated and there's no relation to the site. What the thesis tries to propose is to improve the quality of life by providing basic social infrastructure, public spaces and connections, and reintegrate the heritage and ecological value of the existing fabric. And it does it through the master plan. So for the primary aim of the master plan is to provide basic healthcare facilities ranging from clinics to local hospitals, providing educational right from the pre-primary level, rehousing the informal settlements and providing affordable housing to densify the area, providing commercial aspects such as local markets, grocery stores for everyday items, providing public open spaces, performance spaces and art galleries, providing infrastructure for guided tours to the fort, bird watching, like waterfront development and boardwalks, reinforcing the heritage and ecological aspects of site through introduction of public programs. This is also taken up for intervention. So the public programs involve a history museum, a mangrove interpretation center, and a mangrove research center that will look after the health of the mangroves. The other concerns that the master plan wants to address is are the public spaces, walkable streets, cycling tracks, urban farming, green cover, biosolids to make the city more sustainable. For the formulation of master plan, existing layers of site are overlaid. So the road, the transport routes, the land use, the public activities, social nodes, And so based on all of this, this becomes the kind of most used road, which is pedestrianized to allow for more public activities. Empty plots of land are used for proposing the upcoming programs. This entire patch of land is demarcated as the heritage and ecological zone. So while coming from the station, an entire heritage walk could be constructed from the station to go like that and become a loop. Mixed-use development is proposed for the basic facilities that were mentioned earlier. So the edge has all the cultural and tourist programs, while the residential programs kind of fall in between, with commercial and institutions kind of scattering all around the site. This kind of green belt is formed along the mangroves. Since topography also, this is the lowest point. All the rainwater could collect here, and this could become like a rain garden with its own micro ecosystem during the rainy season. Yeah, so that's the pedestrianized edge with seating along the shopfront, cycling tracks, and shaded streets. Local markets around the railway station, promenades along the waterfront with cycling tracks, seatings, performance amphitheaters, and performing spaces along the edge. Yeah. So that's the proposed master plan along with the larger eastern waterfront plan proposed by the HCP. The green belt tries to continue this idea of the green belt and tourism activities that happened over here, while retaining the essence of the site. So that's the site taken up for intervention with the fort and the dargah, which are retained. According to the State's Department of Archaeology and Museum, it proposes a 100-meter no development zone. It is suggested that there be no development here. It is to protect the fort and its precinct of the city development that happens. But the mangrove edge and this road over here already does it for Sivri's fort. Also, ancient monuments and archaeological sites and remains bill kind of allows for construction of public works in this prohibited area of 100 meters for public purposes. Also, this kind of takes up too much site, which could be used for housing or other purposes. There's no relation to the fort if the building is placed outside this 100-meter zone also. Looking at how the building form came about, placing the blocks like this on the building on the site would have occupied too much ground, rendering all of this space useless. So instead, the building is placed linearly like this, which frees up the ground for public use, and also it maintains relation with the fort and the mangrove throughout. 20-meter offset is set from the mangroves as per CRZ1. Vantage points are placed onto that linear form to add bulk to the building. Again, setbacks are taken to make the building wrap around and maintain this distance from the fort. The site yellow part is all CRZ2, and this blue is CRZ1 with the 20-meter offset. So the building is on CRZ2 land, which allows for standard DCR FSI construction, while ecotourism activities like boardwalks and pavilions are kind of coming out to onto the mangroves in CRZ1 area, which is also allowed by law. So, sectionally, the building's height is always kept below the fort so as to respect the fort's presence. The roof kind of lifts up, the plinth kind of goes down and creates this volume to experience the mangroves and the water's edge. In pavilions and viewing decks, where the building kind of comes onto the mangrove, it is lifted up, it looks towards the fort and goes towards the mangroves to like on it floats above the mangroves. Looking at the building elevation, the fort is this is the fort. It is the highest point. The highest point of the upper floor of the building has all the exhibition areas, where the lower floor has all the services and offices, office spaces. Looking at the program strategy, there are four major programs: Mangrove Research Center, Temporary Exhibition, History Museum, and Mangrove Interpretation Center. So these blocks are all major exhibition areas that are there, and the other become all circulation and services. Looking at the Mangrove Research Center, so the upper floor has main programs, while the offices and ancillary programs go down. So these yellow ones are the laboratories, with that being the cafeteria. for the staff. These are the office spaces, that's a library, that's a laboratory, and these are circulation and services. For the temporary exhibition, again, exhibition areas on the upper floor, there's one below also, and the office area on the lower floor. For History Museum, exhibition areas, viewing decks, that's a museum shop on the lower floor, services and circulation. For the Mangrove Interpretation Center, that's the exhibition area, that's the museum shop. On the lower floor, as you go, there's a cafeteria and office and storage. So that's the pavilion on the ground, and it extends as a boardwalk into the mangroves. Yes, so the building sits like this on site, where it kind of extends out into the boardwalk and kind of touches just the mangroves and wraps in again. Looking at access and circulation, so that's the road from the station where you can come from. That's the entry for the staff of the research block. For the public entry to the museum, they enter from here. They can go up like this. From here, you can visit the fort and continue your journey into the interpretation center. You can just leave from there. After the interpretation center, you can come into the boardwalk like that and then leave the building like that. The entry to the fort and this boardwalk is kept open for public to access. We'll be looking at the building in this five blocks planned in section simultaneously. So research block, that's there, temporary museum, viewing gallery, history museum, and mangrove interpretation center. That's the fort, that is the dargah. Those are the access kind of routes available. So this is the uppermost plan, that is lower plan, and that's the last floor plan. So we'll start with the research block first. So for every block, there'll be two floors that we'll see. So right side is the lower and the left side is the uppermost plan. Into the research block, you enter from the lower level, the entrance lobby, there are offices. Take up the staircase, go above, there are laboratories upside. Once you come down, the toilet, and then again the library, which serves the staff as well as the public, students or researchers from outside who want to use it. There's this library and office and storage. From here, you can take up the staircase and go into the cafeteria on above. That's exclusively for the staff. For the public, public enters from here. There's entrance gallery, ticket, baggage counter, exhibition area, and you take up the staircase and go in on the other floor. So this canteen has no access for the public as such. We'll be looking at a section from here. So that's the section. The Trans Harbour Link. I'll just go back into the plan once. Yeah, so this is the Trans Harbour Link that we are seeing in this section. So that's the Trans Harbour Link. The building kind of looks inwards and does not open up on this side. It looks into this kind of a courtyard that's there with steps and seatings available under the trees. It kind of becomes like a breakout space for the staff. Yeah. We're now into the next block. So the public entrance gallery, exhibition area, you climb up the staircase and you come into the another exhibition area and go down. So this is the canteen for the staff. It kind of steps down here like that. We'll see a section through here. That's the section. So this is the step down that we were talking about. So being a eastern facade, there's no sunlight after the after 12 in the afternoon, and it becomes like a cool and shady place to kind of sit and have lunch. So that is the exhibition area, which kind of opens up towards the mangroves and looks down into the amphitheater where public programs can be happening. The building has this viewing decks, bridges kind of things, again viewing decks that kind of comes down, bridges, and then boardwalks that go into the mangroves. We'll move on to the next block. Yeah, so now we are into the viewing gallery. From the exhibition area, you come up here. This becomes like a breakout space, media room, exhibition gallery again. There are more viewing decks over here. You can go like that. The floor below it becomes the office for the exhibition area. So this access is provided from here after the museum is shut. Things could be brought down from here into the storage area like that. Kind of gives another access. So we'll be looking at a section from here. Yeah, so that's the section. It kind of looks into the fort again, like that, with tree shading any direct sunlight that the block may get. Again, it kind of dips down like that, hovers onto the mangroves. Moving on to the next block, right behind the fort, the public can walk up from the upper level. You can take down the stair. So this is again the exhibition space. Take down the stair down the museum shop. You can leave from here into the fort. Again, come back and go ahead into the interpretation center. From here, we go ahead. Oh, sorry. So that's the section we'll be looking at now. So this section has the fort view. So this is all glass skin that's there. So you have the fort kind of being seen from here, the mangrove seeing from here, and also there's a skylight over here. So you have the sky also. So it kind of becomes like a seamless experience that's there. Looking at these boardwalks, it is completely made from wood so as to kind of let the boardwalk blend into the mangroves and not look out of place. Screw piles are used for the foundation of boardwalks that we'll talk ahead in detail. Yeah, so the last block is the Mangrove Interpretation Center. Public walks up from the upper level, that's the exhibition area. Museum shop, you exit the museum from here. There's a cafe down below here. From here you can go to the boardwalk. There's this office and storage for the curators of the museum. This kind of a courtyard kind of becomes like an extension to the cafe with trees and soft ground that's there. So we'll be looking at this section right here. So yeah, so that's block one and that's block two. It kind of looks towards the fort, looks into the courtyard with a bridge kind of hovering above the cafe and trees kind of shading the space. Yeah, so that's how the entire, that's an exploded 3D of all the blocks. Moving ahead to technology. Prefabricated materials are used. So prefabricated rectangular hollow section double columns with rectangular hollow section beams support and on which hollow core slabs are opted and aerated concrete blocks are used for walls. So they're locally available, they're lightweight materials, and prefabrication helps to reduce the construction footprint. Since the site is a hill, pad footing is preferred as no deep foundation is required. Wherever the building kind of goes into the mangrove, screw piles are used. So screw piles are basically eco-friendly since there's minimum mobilization impact. It can be installed in limited access areas. There's no vibration or minimum noise disturbances that happen while installation. Looking at wall sections, again we'll go block by block. So the first is the research block. So that's the wooden louvers that are adjustable that kind of projects out from the building. It kind of helps in protecting the facade from direct heat gain. Yeah, so the hollow sections, columns and beams are kind of supporting the hollow core precast slab. Metal C channels are used to kind of cover up the edges of such. So this is the canteen area. So this is the second block, the canteen and the museum space over here, right there. Moving to the next block. So for here, the idea was to keep this like a transparent kind of a thing. No risers have been used, so while you're walking up, kind of you can see the mangroves from there. Kind of gives the feeling that you're like walking just above them, floating over it. Yeah, so that's the block up behind the fort with the glass skylight supported by metal framework. And the same kind of hollow section beam column with a double glazed unit as the skin. So the same kind of section is also followed here. So seasonal adaptation of the building. So during the monsoon, that becomes the high tide line where water reaches up to here. After the monsoon season, the water recedes and all these mud flats are kind of occupied by flamingos. So the building gives you proximity but also keeps kind of a distance from the habitat of the flamingos. So you'll see a lot of mangrove have been cut down because of the construction of the Trans Harbour link. There's a project in Java, Indonesia, where they use permeable wooden barriers to capture sediment, which kind of helps in making a strata for the mangroves on which they can regrow. So such barriers are proposed on places where mangrove depletion has happened. Also, there's a larger belt of mangroves just above Sivri from Wadala from through Mahul to Tombe. So this entire patch could be connected and could become like a larger coastal ecosystem, which could make it even stronger. Looking at passive climate response, the wooden louvers extend out from the facades, large overhangs help shading the interiors from heat gain. The glass is majorly used as a skin for to allow for visibility. So wherever the glass is used is a double glazed unit, low emissivity and heat reflective, so as to reduce the heat gain but still allow for visibility. So these are the museum spaces that require air conditioning and the research block that require controlled environment. So desiccant cooling system has been adopted to air condition such spaces. What it does is uses water as a refrigerant instead of CFC and HFC. It cools by dehumidifying the air, which is perfect for hot and humid climate like Mumbai's. The operational cost is low and low electricity consumption happens. UGT is placed at a higher altitude. Since the toilets are at lower altitude, there's no need for a overhead tank. Loft tanks are provided above the toilets. For rainwater, biosphere will have been given all around the site, and a retention point which is at the lowest elevation is provided, so all this water could flow here and this could become like a small mini ecosystem of its own. There are rainwater harvesting tank also which are given to collect the catchment water off the roof of the building. Yeah, so that's the area calculation, population calculation. That's the end. Thank you.